This is a podcast I've always wanted to do, man.
Really?
Because I wanted to, you know, I work with a lot of different people behind the scene clinically, but just wanted to talk about entertainment, mental health, and then because what I did in grad school is I broke down lyrics, and I would break down lyrics and break down the Bible, and make it relatable to like, oh, this is the the transgression or the progression of where somebody is. And
that's crazy.
And my professor was just like, the white guy, he was just like, this is crazy. He was like, 30 years, I've never seen anyone take things like this, but I'm like, this is how you connect to the culture.
Mm-hmm.
But this is culture competency.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, man.
You know what I mean? So this
this is going to be good.
Yeah, this is going to be real good.
Awesome.
Crazy. Copy the turbo soon as they uncuff them. This goes out to all of your mans. Why put you in a verse when I could put you in a car in a van? D block.
They shooting. Oh, Major.
Jesus.
Yeah. Shout out to Salam Remy, the producer of that joint.
Never better set it off with Salam.
Let's go. Welcome to another week of We Sound Crazy. Billionaire is in the building.
Claude Kelly is in the building.
Chuck Harmony is here.
Bacon from Macon is here. What's going on?
What up, Bacon?
What up, y'all?
What's good?
Up, man? What's going on?
Man, I'm excited about this episode right here.
I'm super excited.
Yeah. I meditated before this episode.
Did you meditate, Chuck?
You got your mind right?
I had to get my mind right.
It is May Mental Health Awareness one, right?
It is Mental Health Awareness.
I've been meditating for the last 3 years since the world changed. So
yeah. Really?
Perfect.
Meditation is key to me, my life as well.
So we got I'm honored. Seriously. Like, we got a special guest with us this week.
Yeah,
he's my brother. He's an author. He's a motivational speaker, mental health therapist, life coach, mentor, youth mentor. He got a lot of stuff that he does. And he's got this amazing book that I bought this. He didn't gift this to me. I actually bought this.
No free swag.
Yeah, no free swag. I purchased the book, Just Heal, Bro. But also, I got y'all copies, too.
Thank you very much.
Including you, Guru. So just
real friends gift people books.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's a good gift.
Well, we got Jay Barnett in the building this week. Make some noise.
What's up, man? Welcome to the Welcome to We Sound Crazy.
Man. Thank you guys for having me, man, because I sound crazy.
when I'm the only the first thing is admit that you have a problem.
It's admitting that, a lot of times I'm the only black male in these mental health spaces, so a lot of times I think I sound crazy. So I think this is very fitting for my daily experiences.
There we go.
When I walk into these different spaces of mental health, having these conversations. But I'm glad and honored to be here with my brother Phil, man. Known him for a few years and happy for his success and his growth and what you guys are doing.
Yeah.
I love the name of We Sound Crazy because half of the stuff that we process in life sounds crazy.
It does.
But doesn't mean that it is. So I love that. So I'm happy to be here, man.
We're gonna chop it up and talk about some deep things today, which I'm excited about.
Super excited. I mean, I got it. The book, I love the back. This says it's such a powerful sentence here. It says, most men live and die in silence of their emotions and feelings because they learn early in life they must invalidate their own selves for the sake of others.
Mm.
Ooh.
That's powerful.
That is powerful.
Wow.
That's powerful.
I just had to state it's on the back of the book.
That is so real because, like, I'm sure you all see, like, on Twitter, like, a lot of times people are always saying, well, men should be doing this and shouldn't be, you know, saying. So it's just like it's dope to have someone like yourself who's a brother and you put a face to what it means, what it can be when you actually acknowledge the fact that you want to heal and you want to, you know, fill in those gaps. Because a lot, both, if you black, I always say if you black, you have some kind of trauma.
Mm.
So it's like, I know me personally, at the top of the pandemic, that pushed it. I had been thinking about it for a while, but it pushed me into therapy. It pushed me to find somebody that I felt like I could connect with, that could help me figure out and kind of pull back those layers to what I was experiencing and what I was feeling. You said earlier that, you're the only black person in a lot of the rooms. What's the growth been like in terms of black men now starting to kind of open the door to mental health and getting therapy and that kind of thing? Like, what have you seen?
Well, the growth has been exponential, man, because I think going back to what you said, putting a face to it, and one of the things that I saw, you know, I was NFL free agent like 17 years ago, and I remember, you know, leaving the NFL space and trying to figure out life. There was no black representation of what a therapist or a counselor or, you know, a person that looked like, you know, to want to talk to somebody. And then, too, it was also the notion that if I go and talk to a counselor, therapist, or and this gets back to upper management or up top, you know, how is this going to affect, you know, my situation here playing? So no guy wanted to ever say he had an issue. And I mean, the world could be falling apart, and you just didn't want to say anything. And as I've shared, you know, my journey over the past 10 years, you know, I'm a two-time suicide survivor. So my godmother found me, you know, under the bed after an overdose. And so when I, you know, came through that and started trying to figure out what was next, you know, this was like 30, 31. So this is only 10 years ago. And a friend of mine was like, man, you got to get some, you gotta get some help. And my godmother's like, you know, you gotta, and I was staying with her at the time, and she's like, why would you do this in my house, you know? And it was one of those things, because as men, we internalize silently. That's why no one never hears the cries of a man, because it's a silent cry. And most of our cries are always in the definitive response of suicide. Women attempt more, but men are more successful with their attempts. Because brothers, when they attempt, it's a gunshot. It's usually something very, you know, absolute. And I knew that I was in my godmother's house. So for me, I wasn't going to shoot myself, because I was conscious that I didn't want to make a mess. So for me, if I can go away peacefully, that was my thought process in that. And transition, you know, and getting into therapy. And finally, one day I was working at a group home with a group of kids. I created a program that was called the Emotional Recovery Program for kids in group homes and girls that were victims of sex trafficking. And the director, a black woman, she said, you should really consider being a therapist. She's like, this work you're doing, like, these kids love it. And the staff is like, everybody's like, man, could he speak to the staff? And I researched it, man, and I prayed about it, and I literally felt that it was a divine calling. And in 2015, I heard the voice of God, just as I'm talking to you guys. He said, go to school. And he said, something is coming, and you're going to be needed. It's exactly what I heard. And go to school. I am the only black man to graduate in my cohort out of 72 students. I was in school 3.5 years, never told anybody, because I'm like, I can't tell black folks I'm trying to be a therapist. Because I remember the first time telling somebody I was going to school to be a therapist at 33 years old, like, nigga, what? how you go from being a ball player to, I had a successful training business, training pro athletes, into this? It's like, Jay, what are you doing? And I went through that process, man, and lo and behold, the pandemic happened, and I emerged, you know, and started sharing and started, you know, creating space, because in the space of mental health, there is no representation for us as black men.
No, there's not.
You know, less than 2% of the psychologists and psychiatrists are black, and less than 1% are black males in this space. And this is out of 41,000.
That's crazy.
It's a huge void, and I relate to everything that you said this far in terms of feeling like you're feeling a need, because a big part of it is that I'm empathetic enough to understand that everyone is going through trauma, but what I experience as a black man going through trauma, because we all go through it, is having to carry the additional burden of when and where you're allowed to exercise your pain. And would be it in public or private, because the way it seems to me is that some people can literally outburst in public, and it's received with empathy, and ours is, there's so much packed into when and where we're allowed to express ourselves, and then on top of that, trying to find trustworthy, credentialed other black men to talk to that are not necessarily embedded in a religion or an education system that may not be allowing them to think open-mindedly about your situation.
Yeah.
It really is rare.
Yeah, it's rare, man, because I tell individuals when I go into the clinic, I was in private practice for about like 2.5 years, and I left because I wanted to do what I'm doing now, being on the road, on the tour. We did 15 cities with the Jess Hill Bro Tour, average 300 to 500 men of color. This year, we'll probably do maybe 10 to 15 because my schedule has increased individually. But it's been a blessing to take therapy into the space of brothers who would never come to therapy.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And it wasn't so much of trying to bring them to therapy, but to create a therapeutic experience that where a brother can feel comfortable, you know. And I tell individuals that I don't take my belief system, I don't take my own personal agenda. I show up as someone who's looking to learn. I never go in as an expert, because you're the expert of your story. Mm-hmm. You know, I work with brothers, you know, from all walks of life. And that part about individuals that can really protect, because to now, you know, mental health has become commercialized.
Very.
Yeah.
And so that frightens me, because you have people who are not credentialed. You have people who are calling therapy, you know, coaching. And it's like, it's not the same. And I'm all about safeguarding people's, you know what I'm saying, not just their livelihood, but just their issues and their trauma. Yeah. Like, I work with a lot of celebrities, a lot of entertainers, and it's a blessing. And I will, and I see people, and it's like, for me, I'm so guarded of people's heart, you know, and not just from what I do, but I think I've always been like that, because as a therapist, we are the gatekeepers of people's secrets and people's idiosyncrasies and different things that they're battling quietly. And so I think that's so sacred to me, especially as black men, because most of the times our stuff has been exploited.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
When we open up, it's thrown back in our face.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
We're weaponized against it. And that's the fear why brothers don't open up. And I was talking to Bishop Jakes, and Bishop Jakes said to me, he says, what you're creating is, you're reaching men who would never go to church and who would never enter therapy. And I said, Bishop, that's what I wanted, because for me, I want brothers to experience a great quality of life and not get to the end of their lives and they're tired, they're exhausted, they have worked hard for their families, and all they get is a gold watch or somebody brings some raggedy socks and, you know, some old wrinkled tie and a pen. Like, I really want brothers to experience what true joy and what bliss really is.
Yeah.
And freeing them from the expectations and the trauma that they are masking, because that's what it is. And I mean, life has become a big masquerade party.
Ain't that the truth?
It has.
Ain't that the truth?
It has.
We sound crazy.
And a lot of these, to your point, a lot of these phrases have become so popular now. Therapy, empathy. There's just a whole list of words that get misused and overused now. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering how that affects you when you're doing the real work and you have to fight against all the new stereotypes and the new popular, you know, things that are happening within that.
You know, it's so challenging, bro, because, you know, oftentimes, going back to what you said, you know, when brothers are being expressive, because here's the difference, and I told someone this, and they kind of, you know, I said, when women express, they're met with compassion, but when we express, we're met with criticism.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not encouraging for me to open up, because if I open up and it doesn't work for me, my brain is now programmed, we'll never do that again.
Yep. Yeah. Never doing it again.
And
definitely.
And even to look at how some female clinicians has, the young lady went off on black men, I think several months back. She was a therapist, and, you know, y'all need to go to therapy. Y'all hurt, y'all broken, and this and that. And then you look at, you know, some of these brothers on the podcast, and you know, it's, I'm gonna call it what it is. It's pandering. It's, you know, if you're not ready to take her to a 5-star restaurant and all this type of stuff, and I'm just like, bro, like that's not how you reach men.
No, it's not.
Mm-mm. It's not how you reach brothers.
Agreed.
Like I've been in locker rooms, and I could tell you, and I've been a leader amongst men. That's not how you reach men. You reach men in a way to where you show respect. Mm. When brothers come in to see me in the clinical space, because I still see individuals virtually, the first thing I do to that black man is I said, bro, I'm proud of you, man. Mm. I'm proud of you for choosing you.
Yeah. Mm.
Because I know this is hard, you know, and you just see the weight just drop. Mm. Because they no longer have to be Superman. Mm. And I'm saying, bro, I just want you to be vulnerable. And I don't have to tell them to be vulnerable. Mm. They can feel it in the space because it's not force feeding. Mm-hmm. It's allowing him to feel seen. And when men feel seen, we feel valued. Mm-hmm. When we feel valued, there's this appreciation to where, okay, I can open up in layers. And I think the world has done a disservice to black men as much as they have to black boys. Mm. To where the world has celebrated our physical abilities, but when it comes to our emotional capabilities, we don't want that.
Wow. Even our intellect is celebrated, yeah. But our emotions are not honored.
No.
That's heavy.
I mean, wow. No, because I remember being young and certain people, like when, you know, when you're a kid, certain things happen, you might have an emotional moment, you might cry, and it's like, shut that fuss up.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. That was definitely me. My mom did not allow me to cry. She was just
really?
Like, ain't no crying. Men don't cry. I've been hearing that my whole life.
Mm. So, let me ask you this, Chuck. Yeah. How was it for you now to cry?
Oh, I cried the drop of a dime. Yeah. No, but and it's because I really understand how freeing that is to mm-hmm. just let it out. Even if I'm doing it by myself, you know what I'm saying? Mm. I have to, because we don't have that many spaces to let it out. You know what I'm saying? Like even if you dating, you know what I'm saying? You start crying on the wrong girl, she'll be like, I don't know what this is. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, like I don't know how to deal with that.
That part, man. That's power. And listen to what he said. You start crying on the wrong girl.
Mm. Right.
You know. Mm. And just think what that does to you the first time you hear, like, chick, I've seen them get on the phone. Girl, this nigga over here crying, like, woo, yeah. Girl, I ain't got time for this.
Yeah.
I thought this nigga was a boss. Right. He over here crying. You know what I'm saying? Like what we doing, right, you know?
Right. And, exactly.
It's true.
And what it's confusing, mm-hmm. right? It's confusing because it says to me as a man, like, okay, I'm a human being.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, I'm a whole person.
A whole person.
Yeah, a whole person. As I say on the tour, is there's a duality in life where we are both. We are lions and a lamb. Mm-hmm. Mm. I can tear some stuff up, but then I also have this compassion to where I can put things back together mm-hmm. because I understand the power of my strength, but I also understand the power of my meekness.
Mm. Yeah.
So I can hold both. So, but don't limit me to just being this. And then when you see my meekness, that's not appreciated to where you reject that. But give me all of this. And what is happening is brothers are tired.
Tired.
Exhausted.
Me and Claude always say, we have the saying, nobody wants to hug a lion. And that's because that's how we feel. Like people see the bravado of a man, but they, like you said, they don't see the meekness or they don't accept that from us. You know what I'm saying? And so it's really difficult to navigate life when you have this duality, but people only cater to this one side or they judge you on that one side.
That's my favorite phrase, by the way. We say it like almost every day, because just being in leadership, there's a point, we talk about this, where you have to bark to get things done. And then a lot of times when you ask nicely, you don't get it done, or if you present yourself and the soft side of yourself that gets run over, and it really it feels like a lion. Like you want to see the lion, you might even fly over there to where the natural habitat and look from afar with binoculars. You'll go to the zoo and see him, but no one really wants to hug the lion.
No,
and no one cares how the lion feels about all of that. Yeah. It's just a spectacle, a big powerful spectacle, and that leaves the actual lion feeling void of any concern or care or love.
Facts. I saw an interesting stat that you had shared in one of your interviews that African-American adults are 20% more likely to experience mental health issues than the rest of the population. Talk about that.
Yes, please.
You know, one of the reasons is the level of care. It's the level of care, and it's also our relationship with the healthcare system. You know, mental health, when it was first created, you know, it's a very Eurocentric element of life. Like, it was created for wealthy white men, so it wasn't created for blacks. And also, the way they had us programmed is that when we looked or thought about mental health, like, I remember being in school and hearing a kid had to go see a counselor. The first thought that came to your mind was that they're crazy.
They're crazy.
Yeah.
You know? And so, for us, we're already battling an identity issue, and we're already battling not being accepted. So do you want to be identified as crazy? No. Mm-mm. Especially if you already feel inferior to your counterpart. Mm. So why would you consider going to therapy? Why would you consider getting help? Because even our family dynamics, right? You don't, I mean, I'm a PK, so I grew up, you know, you don't go to therapy, you go to God.
God, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right? And so having that that process of trying to navigate life with these different mechanisms that's not effective. Because here's what I know that our white counterparts know. If you get your mind right, you get your life right.
That's mm-hmm. right. Yeah, man.
And our biggest challenge is that our mindsets are not right. And of course, we could talk about the slavery, we can talk about the Jim Crow, we can talk about all these things that were systematically put in place to control our mindset, which affects your mental health. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, not to be biblical, but if you look at the children of Israel, you came out, but you didn't come out.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You came out physically, but your mind was still in prison. Mm-hmm. Your mind was still in Egypt. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have more issues in the black population mentally, because even though slavery is over and we're free, our minds are still not free.
Yeah.
And when your mind is not free, your soul is in bondage.
Mm-hmm.
When your soul is in bondage, what happens? It breaks your body down. It's the reason why we have more sickness and disease in our community.
Mm.
So everything is not just food, but of course food plays a role in it, but mental health is your physical, your mental, and your spiritual well-being. And guess what that does? That impacts your relational experiences.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Plus worry creates disease, right?
So. Exactly. And so stress. So you look at our issue, and then you look at, I think, was it 40% black men, you know, won't seek help because...
40%.
40%.
I'm surprised that's lower than I thought.
40%. And so...
I thought it would have been 80.
I keep my notes on hand. In 2020, suicide was the third leading cause of death amongst African American males ages 15 to 24.
Mm-hmm.
And also, statistics tells 25% of African Americans seek mental health treatment compared to 40% of white Americans.
Jeez.
So it is.
And another stat that I saw that you talked about, that 95% people of color will end therapy prematurely. Like, usually after the first session.
I've done that.
Because of the cultural divide with the therapist.
I've done that several times. I've done that. It's been a one-night stand with the therapist, for sure.
100%. So let's talk about that. Like, what was that? Like, what happened in the clinical experience that caused you to end that?
Well, the first thing is culturally. It's feeling like the person, most times it's been a white woman, and I felt like she's been good enough but not really heard me.
Mm.
And then for me personally, I consider myself a pretty smart guy. I do a lot of homework. I do a lot of self-work myself. So I'll run as soon as I feel like you're giving me elementary tools far simpler than where I think than what I'm trying to express to you. So if you're telling me, like, you know, you need to, I'm already doing the breathing exercises, you know what I'm saying? I'm already meditating, I'm already working out, I'm already praying, I'm already reading books, I've done a lot of that homework, so I don't need you to start from kindergarten. And so it feels like it's a waste of time. That's the second thing. And then every year you get older, it feels like there's more to unpack. And so you're like, God, I gotta start at the beginning. Like, yeah. And that feels like a lot of burden. That feels like a lot to unpack from, okay, I was born, right? And then here's what started to happen, all right? Like and so there's a fatigue that sets in right away. Like, yeah. God, if I gotta unpack third grade, then, you know what I'm saying? Then how am I ever get to college and then get to adulthood and to yesterday? Because yesterday was stressful. And so that it's easier to quit than it is to stick with it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But also, like, currently I'm looking a bunch of people that in my circle, we talked about looking for therapists, and it's hard to find a black male therapist, which is what I think I need.
I've got one here in town, here in Nashville.
Yeah.
I've been going to the last 3 years.
The reason I haven't
asked. If he can survive me.
The reason I haven't asked is normally therapists will not take you, in my experience, if they're treating someone that you know very well. So, because I know, I'm aware. There's a bunch of people that I'm aware of, but also, like, they're always so sensitive about conflict of interest that they'll say things, and then they'll refer me to someone, which is probably still good, but that's the reason why I haven't reached out. But these are all this is the reasons why we don't reach out. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Why we don't talk it through.
Well, Claude, if you just promise don't talk about me in your session.
I'm like, let's start with Phil and how he is the main cause of my stress. You know what I'm saying? Why are you here? Phil.
But it's just important. I got to tell you, it's been life-changing for me.
Yeah.
Like, because I've experienced so much trauma in some ways, and you don't realize it is trauma because I remember even as a child, 5 years old, growing up in very humble community, and the lady across the street murdered her husband.
Mm.
And I'm 5 at that time. And I just remember seeing the ambulance and all these people, like, and my mom telling me, like, yeah, that, you know, she killed her husband. And I didn't even think about just the impact that it had on my mental. Just, you know, just that, and just being around different settings on the road with different artists and things happen. And then you kind of self-medicate.
Yeah.
You know, whether that's alcohol, some people's drugs, some people's food, some people's sex, or all of the above.
All the above.
but you don't realize it. And again, I didn't realize it, honestly, until I was in my, I say, earlier 30s once I moved here to Nashville.
Yeah.
And that's when I was like, you know what? I started just thinking about the journey and talking to friends. Because I started with a therapist in L.A. who I enjoyed, but it still, I didn't feel that connection. So I went on this journey to find, you know, a black male therapist, just because there were certain nuances and just certain things that I had experienced. Yeah. And, you know, being raised by a single mom and having, you know, issues with my father not being there and reconciling that now.
That's issue number one.
Yeah, but that's a real issue, though. And the thing is, but I had to take ownership on some level, but some of it I just had to address it head on. Like, me and my dad, we're great now. He's also someone who's dealt with a lot on his journey of life, mental health-wise, but it's something I'm just learning to how to navigate even that relationship in a different kind of way. So it's just, again, you learn. And this, you know, I'm living and learning every single day, just trying to be a better human being. And that's really just been a journey.
That's encouraging, because I mean, because I've had therapy for a good window, too, in New York. And then I've moved around a lot and settled here, and I'm looking right now actively. So I'm on the market. I'm looking, but I mean, it's about trust.
And that's critical in the clinical experience. And I tell individuals, if you don't have, because it's a relationship, and if you don't have trust with the therapist, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
And I think you know, healing, man, as I've said for the past 3 years, it's truly a journey. It's a journey, man. You know, you get on it, and sometimes, like, I never have a client come every week. You know, I usually do, like, every two, every three, because I want them to process. Because healing is frustrating. As much as social media has made it look like running through these bed of roses and, you know, you taking these baths and doing all these affirmations. Bro, that ain't
burning
real.
Incense.
That ain't, you know, burning sage and burning incense. That ain't healing.
Yeah.
Healing is really opening up that wound and going deep in that thing, and sometimes digging in that womb to irritate it.
Yeah.
Because you got to irritate it. You know, like, my father wound was so deep, bro. I'm talking about so deep. I talked about this last Friday. I was teaching at a church on the burden of unforgiveness. Man, that thing was so deep, man. Because I would watch this man preach on Sunday, And Monday through Saturday, man, it was a different lifestyle. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like, I was telling somebody, man, I remember at 5 years old, I was with my father, and this was the first time, like, I didn't even know what was happening. We were at a lady house that I knew that wasn't my mom. And I remember him telling me to stand here in this room, and I remember him grabbing the lady's hand, and they went to the back. And I remember when he came out, don't tell your mama where we've been. And I remember the lady having a glass of wine. I could still see it to this mm-hmm. day. I could still see this glass of wine with her lipstick imprint on it. And bro, that messed me up. Mm. And I remember my mom, like, where did y'all go? And me not saying anything. And then later, you know, years later coming back, and she said, I knew what was happening. But I also, it was all of that because I'm trying to, because you can't process that as a kid mm-hmm. because on Sundays, it's, you know, God is great and husband, love your wives. And I'm like, this doesn't make sense. Mm. So my father wound was so deep, man, to where I was literally challenged to revisit those scenes. Mm. And what I tell people is the only way to heal is sometimes you have to walk back in the room where it happens, walk through it. And this is what I've done with most clients, because I tell therapists that are coming up that reach out to me, if you haven't done your own work, you can't take your client through it.
Right.
You can only go as deep with your client as deep as the work that you've done within yourself. Mm-hmm. And I walked into that room and I had to revisit 5-year-old Jay, because you got to rescue the little boy.
Yeah.
Think about the men that we see today. That the man is successful, but the boy is broken. The man is driving the car, but the little boy is still stuck where daddy left him, where mama left him, where the uncle touched him, where the aunt said this. And we dress up the man, but there's this little boy on the inside saying,
"Woo,
hey, what about me?" Damn. And what happens is, in a relationship, in a circumstance, the little boy or the little girl can always stick their head out. And what we do, get back.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And because if they're seen, now they know who we really are.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's why I say if we don't heal the childhood wound, it destroys the adult.
Yeah.
It destroys adulthood. And that, as Phil was saying, like, me and my father now are, you know, he's my biggest fan, but it took 10 years to work through the forgiveness and until this day, you know, it is what it is. Dude called when he wants something. Mm. He would never tell me how great I am. Now, I hear it through everybody else.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Charlemagne, I think we was at the Breakfast Club, and he says, Jay, what is that like, you know, because, you know, when I left football, my dad play ball. I come from an NFL family. Just, you know, this is what you did. And I was tired. I said, man, I'm tired of these trials. I'm tired of bouncing around team to team. And I didn't realize his whole identity was attached to me still playing, because he didn't get the chance to do it.
Mm.
So when I walked away, he had an issue with that.
Mm.
And I didn't know it. And I remember Charlemagne, we was talking, he says, man, you know, how do you feel not having that validation, you know, from your dad? And this is when I knew that my healing was alive. I said, bro, I would love to have it, but I can't wait for it.
Mm.
I can't hold my life, you know, in a prison waiting for daddy to say, I'm proud. And it would be good to have it, and it would be good to hear those words, but the little boy in me has to go free.
Yeah. Mm.
So the man can be free. Because you set the boy free, the man can live in the liberation of the freedom of the little boy. And so healing that, man, has really brought me to a place of ease.
Mm.
That I would love for him to call me every week and tap in with me, but he don't.
Right.
You know, I would love for him to just, like, my father would not have. Now, here's what he would do. He's still a pastor. 3 weeks ago, he hits me up, and he'll reach out for different clues on text when he's preaching. And, you know, he knows I'm gifted to take scriptures and connect it, you know, from theology to faith, psychology and all that. And he was, hey, I'm looking at this scripture. Tell me what you think and, you know, give me some feedback on it. And once he get it, he's gone. I won't hear from him about another 2 weeks.
Oh, he's like, cool, got my sermon. Thank you. He's like, thank you. Thank you for a nice Sunday.
Yeah. And I won't hear from him. And, bro, that used to break me down, Chuck. I mean, I'm talking about field. I would be in corners when I was in my early 30s, bro. That would just shut me down. Now, you know, I just, that's him. That's you know, a, and it doesn't, and again, I'm sharing that because oftentimes we're wanting people to change in order for our healing to be valid.
Yeah.
What makes my healing valid is that even if you don't change, I'm okay.
Wow. Mm. Wow. What makes my healing valid is that even if you don't change, I'm okay.
You feel me?
That's real.
That's crazy. Because you're literally speaking, just candidly speaking, I'm currently dealing with just the fact that the idea of me having this, you know, idealistic relationship with my dad, and it's just like, Timon, that what you envision in your head all these years, it may not ever come to pass. So you have to settle with the fact that you gotta not necessarily meet him where he is, but just understand that y'all are two totally different people, and he's who he is, and you just have to kind of either you want to communicate with that or you don't. And so that's just some things that I've been, so just hearing you kind of speak through it, I'm like, yo, this is really a thing for a lot of black men.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Everyone's sitting here, right? Like, it's interesting to hear y'all say that, because what I've been coming to terms with in the last couple months is that I also didn't know my father, but I also don't believe he's alive, so I never really got to know him. So it's about identity for me. Wow. Because identity for me has, up until recently, I built my work ethic and everything about me built off of the, like, well, I'll show you. You're going to regret that you never ... And so that's the reason why I work hard, why I'm ambitious. Not the only reason, but a big chunk,
it's
right?
It's a driving force.
It's a driving force, right? And so then in recent years, I just started to ask myself, well, what does life look like if it's not built off of revenge, or built off of like trying to show someone, like, what does life look like if you're enjoying it just because life is enjoyable, not because you're trying to reach this mountaintop to say, see, I told you, or you missed out.
Yeah.
And that's a scary place to, I think life is probably richer and better on that other greener side, but it's still a tough pill to swallow, because you can build a whole life around the fact that you've been neglected, abandoned, treated poorly. And that can become your male identity. And that may not actually even be who you really are. It's just the armor that you've built in so well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a maladapted persona, right? And also, as I say, anger is a great motivator, but it's not a great sustainer.
Yes. Mm.
And you can build some things from anger, but you can't. And again, that's what we do.
Yeah.
Like
it fuels you.
It fuels you.
Yeah.
You know, but it's not a great sustainer.
But to your point about physical, like, it's a great physical fuel, but it's not great emotional fuel.
No. And that's why football was just like my thing. That's why when it was over for me, man, I was just like, it wasn't about the money. It was like, you know, I wasn't a drinker. I wasn't a smoker. Like, I just wanted to put that helmet on and just get to work.
Yeah.
Because I can take out all of my aggression and my pain, like even boxing. Like, that's why I box 3 days a week, because I still have to have that, you know, that outlet. But for me, you know, I was talking about last week, you know, I remember playing this game and this dude was talking so much trash, man, and he was blitzing, and I knew he was blitzing. And man, he was a big dude, big old linebacker, like 6'2", 6'3", 240, man. And I mean, he was just like, yeah, nigga, I'm coming. Nigga. And like, bro, when I kid you not, it went silent. And all I did was I saw my dad's face. Mm. And when he came through the blitz, bro, it was like, woof. And brought him to his knees. Mm. Like he brought him to his knees, and he was almost like in a praying position. And I said, bro, what I got inside of me, dude, is on a whole nother level, dude. So, and that's when I knew, I said, this is scary.
Yeah.
This is scary. And I started in therapy, man. I had to revisit all of that, man. You know, because you can't run from you.
You can't run from you.
You take you everywhere.
It's going to catch up with you at some point.
Can't run from you.
Okay. I tried.
I still try.
Daily.
Same OG.
Yeah.
So a lot of times, I know when we were just talking about the reasons that for us stopping counseling, one of the reasons, well, back in the day was that it was a financial thing. Like, you just can't afford it. To go to counseling. So my question is, like, what resources or what can people do to begin their healing process on their own if they can't afford to go to therapy?
You know, we have been trying to figure out, you know, so many ways to simplify the process, because the process, man, if you don't have insurance or if you work for a corporation, they may say, hey, we'll provide 4 free sessions. And we all know, man, like, that's nothing, man. Yeah, yeah. You know, Taraji, her and Tracy, you know, they're great friends of mine, man. What they're doing with the Boris Henson providing free therapy to Black men, man, has been so paramount to brothers who can't get to therapy and can't afford it, and they don't have the job to pay for it, man. They have doing great work. Black Men Heal, they're doing great work. So there are some resources. It's not many. I think the challenge is now the solution doesn't meet the demand. Mm. Because now you have all these brothers that are coming out and say they want therapy, but it's not enough therapists.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know, that's not enough, you know, skill therapists that are competent, because not only do you need to be culturally competent, but you need to be culturally sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And yeah, so... Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I think that's a challenge, and that's why we started the tour, because I told my team, I was like, man, sitting in the office all day seeing one person is not going to make an impact.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wanted to make a ripple of effect to where this thing, you know, expands, because if a brother doesn't go to therapy and he comes to the Just Heal Bro tour, he can at least get an understanding, okay, this is where I start. Because at each city, we have, you know, local therapists, people who have resources, and they come out on stage, and it's always one or two guys.
Mm.
And you got one or two guys, and you got 40 guys, like, hey, man, I'm ready for therapy. And it's just kind of like, whoa. You know, I've seen some therapists that are like 6 months booked. You know, my therapist that I see, dude, like, you can't get on his waiting list for another year.
Crazy.
You know, so how do you manage that? And
what's crazy, the same thing goes for Black physicians too.
Mm-hmm.
It's all tied in together.
Yeah. Yeah, it's all tied in together. Yeah.
Trying to find a Black doctor, a Black dentist.
Yes.
The same.
So, I can help you out there.
No, you did help me.
Yeah, I did.
Thank you very much. Yeah. But I mean, there's a lot more demand than there is.
Yeah, and that's why representation, man, is so important, man. And that's why I love that, you know, I was part of the sports world and being part of this clinical space as well, to bridge that gap, you know, especially even in entertainment, because what you see is. You see this a lot in entertainment, that we are so quick to get these artists a bag, but you're not giving them, you know, a healthy community to support.
Mm-hmm. That part.
Mm-hmm. True.
You know, that fame only makes mental problems worse. It's an amplifier.
What? Wow. Oh, my God.
People don't know that part. We don't talk about that part, but that fame makes things way worse if you're not ready for it.
Yeah.
We sound crazy.
Bringing them boys to men. Them boys pull win. This is grown man B.I. Get you rolled in the triage.
Takeover. What a classic diss record.
Classic. Oh my God.
Because I love Nas and Jay. I'm actually.
Do you?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah,
you should.
Yeah.
Top five.
Yeah.
You
top
agree?
Five. Yeah, I absolutely agree.
You asked us a question earlier about Blueprint and Ether.
Yeah.
Yeah. What was that question?
Hit us with the question again so I can think about it properly.
Which would you guys choose?
Oh, God. You got to choose between Jay, Blueprint, or Nas, Ether. What you think? Feel like you're ready to respond.
Jay came out strong with Takeover. You can't deny it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can't deny it. But that Ether.
But that Ether, though?
Yeah.
That Ether, though?
And then Jay came back with the response to Ether. which went a different direction. But if I'm picking, Ether.
Really?
Yeah.
Nah, Ether was a monster.
The penmanship, man.
Right. Yeah. That's what he was talking. I mean, he was so clever with how he was dismantling Jay-Z.
Yeah.
On Ether. I would have to go with Ether too.
Yeah.
No, I'm going Blueprint. Sorry, guys.
It's like I'm going Blueprint, yo.
So
I'm
New York.
Blueprint, yo.
Oh, they're
yo.
Both New York.
They're both
so
New,
New
York,
York
but
yeah.
I'm going Blueprint.
Take over for me. Blueprint.
Yeah. So what about you, Jay?
It's tied.
I have to go with Ether. I love Jay, and I love the Blueprint album. But, I mean, when you look at, as Chuck said, the perfect depiction is dismantling.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I mean, it was layered. By layer. I mean, it was just like he didn't miss. I mean, it was just like a punch. I mean, it's almost like in boxing, right? If you can throw the perfect combination, like Nas threw it.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, so yeah, it was. But you know what? But what I love about both of their display of artistry was it brought the best out of them.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was the best music that we had, I mean, agreed. During that time, man. Yeah. I mean, it was just like, you know, rap beef these days is like, you know. Yeah.
Now, people discount what good, healthy competition can do to for everything. I mean, like having your counterpart, whether regardless of who quote unquote wins, which you can never really debate that in any of these, but how it drives both sides to just be their best.
Yeah. And then, too, you look at the beauty of it, right? And this is what I love, like, you know, just seeing these brothers age well and seeing the friendship and the brotherhood.
Mm-hmm.
And again, it's, you know, it goes back to, you know, seeing the growth of who we are as human beings. And I think we don't see enough of that as Black men because a lot of time we don't live long enough.
You don't live long enough.
So, you know, we either don't live long enough or we don't see the growth from, there's no maceration process in us. Right? Because you'll see some guys that are still the same 20 years later.
For sure.
You know? I think Tony Yayo was talking about this, and he said, man, I act my age. And he was like, I'm not 20 anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so to see the growth of Jay and Nas, and, you know, from a business standpoint, you look at what Jay has built, and you look at what Nas has built, the investments, and, you know, from tech into the liquor, the alcohol, into, you know, Jay buying paintings and all this. It's a beautiful evolution of who we are as Black men that we don't have to remain the same.
That's right.
And we don't see that very often.
No, we don't. And then, too, it's like it also allows me to adjust my expectations even if they drop new music. The inspiration is not the same.
Right.
Because I'm in a different place in life.
Very true. Yeah.
When I'm speaking for pain, oh, my God. Take Wayne for an example.
Mm-hmm.
You look at what he put out, you know, with the Carter 2 and the Carter 3, different inspiration.
Mm-hmm.
And people are like, well, he's not the same. He's in a different place.
He shouldn't be the same.
Yeah. So, you know, of course, his music is not going to be the same. But, you know, and this is why I think it's important for therapy. And this is a shameless plug in therapy. Therapy allows you to grow in ways you would never grow. Because you're not challenged to grow outside of that space. I have seen brothers that, you know, I can't talk about football anymore. I'm not there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and I tell brothers, man, be careful when you're around guys that are like Al Bundy, who are stuck in who they were.
Al Bundy.
You know, I call it the Al Bundy syndrome.
Sit on the couch with his hand in his pants, just not changing.
Yeah. Man, exactly. Yeah. And it's like, you know, you're bringing out your championship rings from 94, and it's like, good brother. You know, I built an empire. You know what I'm saying? So it's, and a lot of brothers don't get there.
Yeah.
You know, growth is difficult.
It is.
It is difficult. I got to ask you, top five MCs, dead or alive?
My top five?
Your top five hip-hop MCs, dead or alive.
We're totally judging you.
Yeah, please do. I'm going to say, this is my top five. I'm going to say Nas 1, Jay 2, Pac 3. My number four, I'm a big Crit fan. Mm. I'm from Mississippi.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think Crit is so underrated, right, bro.
Not talked about at all.
Man, bro, like, I mean, oh my gosh, man. Like, I jam Crit, man, a lot. he would be my number four because I listen to storytelling, but I also listen to, like, a lot of these guys, man, provide a lot of psychological storytelling. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? The artistry in their metaphors and the artistry in their analogies and stuff. I love that, man. I love to dig into, you know, their minds. And so, and I think the way I appreciate artists is probably a lot different. And I think I've been like this before I became a therapist. My number five, man, part of me wants to say M, and then the other part of me wants to say my good brother Royce the 5'9".
Mm-hmm. Okay. Shout out to Royce the 5'9".
Okay.
Yeah.
We respect these choices.
Yeah. Yeah. Man, it's all solid. Yeah. Yeah. And I'm different, you know what I mean? So, but like Royce and Crit, these are guys that I have really just, like Royce's last album, man, that he put out, man, I was just like, dude. Like, we did a live one night, man. I was just, because again, to open your mind up in a way to see the world in these different colors, man, is a gift. It's, mm-hmm. it's unique, you know? But, and that's mental health. And again, when I'm saying mental health, I'm not talking about the depression. It's just how, I say mental health is life in real time. Mm-hmm. It's life in real time, right? Physical, the spiritual, you know what I'm saying? The emotional aspects of it. And just seeing how these guys, you know, embody all of these different elements of mental health where you're talking about financing, you're talking about getting healthy, you're talking about building your generational wealth and all those things, man. So those are my top five, man.
I'm interested in knowing, not since we're on the topic of music and this is a music podcast, like, is there an artist or an album or song that you go to when you feel like it might just be getting to be too much and you can put that record in and it just kind of helps you to kind of chill out?
You know what? I'm an R&B guy.
Okay.
When I do that. And believe it or not, man.
Don't you say Jeffrey Osborne. Jeffrey Osborne listening guy.
Let the man live. You know what I'm saying? He likes Jeffrey O.
Jeffrey O.
Oh, man.
He likes Jeff O. You know what I'm saying?
But man, believe it or not, bro, Gucci gets me there.
Okay.
Gucci, man.
Gucci brings the peace.
Yeah.
Like, I was in a gifted and talented class as a kid and I didn't understand why. Mm. 7 years old, my parents pulled me out and they literally says, you're different. And I'm just kind of like, what that is, you know? And so I had a lot of spiritual gifts as a kid, still have them, you know, and I didn't understand what was happening, man. And so for me, I could go into someone else's world and live in it, and figuratively, and live in it and have this appreciation that brings ease because I now get to see from a different view. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, like just hearing Gucci rap, man, it just, because you hear his storytelling, right? Like mm-hmm. one of my favorite songs is Heavy, but for me, as I'm listening to it, he's really rapping about, you know, how the process is heavy. But then as I'm listening to it, it's lightening my heavy load. Mm-hmm. And wow. So there's this contrast to it.
Yeah.
That's good.
I love that.
Who would have been your R&B person?
A Tank.
Tank?
Yeah.
Brother there Tank. We go.
R&B yeah. Money.
Yeah. R&B Money. Shout out R&B Money.
Listen, that R&B Money album.
It's a great record.
You like it?
Yeah.
Brother. It's a great record. Oh, my gosh.
I'm curious. I mean, we don't have to spend too much time about it, but I'm going to go around. I'm curious to know, like, we always do Mount Rushmores, but Phil and everyone else afterwards, like, one. What's the one artist you go to that what's the one that calms you down? What's your
And it better not be no Jeffrey Osborne.
It better not be no Jeffrey Osborne.
That one artist?
Who centers you?
It's a song that centers. It's a song that I listen to that by the Sounds of Blackness. Mm. It's called Optimistic.
Yeah.
Optimistic.
Oh yeah, that's good.
I love that one.
That That just, it brings me back in. It puts me in such a good space. Even when I have a crazy day, like, or just, I try to start my day with that song a lot of times. So that's a song that gives me in the right emotional space.
Timon, what about you? That's good.
In like the last 3 or 4 years, I've gone to Shirley Horn, specifically the album Here's to Life. And I just discovered her like maybe 5 or 6 years ago, but like I can literally say, Alexa, please shuffle Shirley Horn.
And it
takes me to a place, it like takes me out of the craziness that's happening that day. So yeah, Shirley Horn for me.
What about you, Claude?
Bob Marley.
That's a good one.
Yeah, that's a good one.
I mean, my family's Jamaican, so for lots of reasons, but it reminds me of where I come from in the most like ancestral way, which always calms me down. But then also reminds me of like what's important. Especially as a musician, because he was just so to the core of.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
So same thing, put it on shuffle, it doesn't matter what song's playing.
Oh yeah.
It just takes me right back to, you know, start mode of just.
Yeah, I love his song. What is it? How's it start off? Is this love?
Is this love?
Yeah, I love that, you know.
Is this love that I'm feeling? Come on, man. Bob is the best.
Man, dude.
What about you, Chuck?
That would be Tracy Chapman.
Yeah.
Tracy Chapman.
Yeah.
I thought you were about to say Trey Songz.
Which one of y'all?
I was like, hey, that's what you would eat? Trick or Trey? He said Trey.
Phil, he drugged that Trey.
It was like Trey. Not Mr. Songz.
Not Mr. Songz?
No. Miss Chapman. All right, she, cool. Every decade of my life since I've been 10 years old, I've had that album in some capacity, and it takes me back to an innocent place in life when I didn't know all the bullshit I know now.
Yeah.
I put that on and I'm back there. I'm just back to my 10-year-old self. Yeah.
It's just good to know everyone's going to listen to when they need something to calm them.
And I'll tell you what I listen to, and I think he's an underrated gospel singer, man. I listen to his song usually before I speak, and it really centers me before I speak. It's Jay Moss. He has a song called Anointing, and that's like my go-to. Because I get anxiety when I speak, man. People think, you know, oh, you do it. It's just like I'm always nervous, which for me, my mentor says a great thing. And I put that song on, man, and it really centers me because I know there's an anointing on what I do because it's you know, and I think there's an appreciation for the oil or for the anointing because this is not things that we could do in and of ourselves.
That's right.
Right. There's a gift, and I think that we all have an anointing in with the abilities that we do, whether it's discovering new talent or managing or you whatever it is that you do. Mm-hmm. And so I think there's always this this appreciation that I have for his body of work, man. Because the guy has so much range, but his voice is so soothing, man, you know, to sort of settle you down, man. So he's an artist, man, that I think I saw it on his Instagram the other day. He was just saying he didn't know.
I watched that video so many times.
Dude. Oh, thank God. I thought I was only one.
Come on, Phil. You know, I know you know Jay Moss, Phil.
I know Jay Moss.
Don't be that person.
He don't know what he about to do. Give him something to do.
Give him something to do. Tell him to come on the podcast.
I'm going
to
call him.
Call Jay.
Man. There's so much to uncover when discussing what goes into building a healthy mind. I hope you've got your pen and pad out for this one, and be sure to share with a friend. Make sure you check out part 2 of our conversation with mental health guru and life therapist, Jay Barnett. Thank you to our sponsors at the National Museum of African American Music, blackmusicmuseum.org. And thank you, Visit Music City.